Welcome everyone to the Water Peace and Security Partnership's online training. I'll be providing you with an introduction to our first training module. My name is Susanne Schmeier. I work at IHE Delft as an associate professor, and I'll guide you through this Water Peace and Security Partnership introductory session. Let's start with why we're here anyway and why we're talking about this topic. I'm not telling you anything new if I'm telling you that water resources have been used by humankind for all sorts of purposes. We need them for drinking water supply and for sanitation. We need them to grow our foods, to do fisheries. We need them for transport, for industries, but also for cultural and spiritual purposes. However, the resources that we need are very limited on this planet. The blue planet might look as if it's water abandoned, and it indeed is, with 97.5% of the world's water resources being stored in salt water. These are, however, not immediately available for human use. What's left, the remaining 2.5%, is fresh water, but that is largely stored in ice caps and in glaciers, so only a small share of those is actually directly accessible for human use. In rivers and lakes and in some aquifers. These resources are moreover distributed very unevenly around the world. Think about water-abundant places, the Congo River Basin in Central Africa, the Amazon Basin in Latin America, or think about very water-scarce regions such as the Middle East, parts of Central Asia, the Sahel. At the same time, the demand for water resources is rising because of population growth, growing economies, growing needs of people, not to even talk about climate change. On the lower map on this slide, you can see the current water risk situation, and you can see in which regions around the world water risk is already on the rise. In order to respond to these challenges, we humans have been developing our water resources since centuries. On the upper slide, you can see in the blue dots a number of large dams around the world, only in a small share of the planet, as you can see here, where humans have tried to capture water to make it more easily accessible, to use it for the generation of hydropower or for irrigated agriculture, which is the way that we usually deal with our water resources. Pressure increases, demand increases, hence we humans try to build more infrastructure and respond to these needs. Water-related risks are also rising as a consequence of this. I was just mentioning growing populations, growing economies. This means that the water demand grows. More people and bigger economies need more water resources. Climate change only exacerbates these risks. It adds threats in the form of more variability within a year, but also interannually, and it increases the risk and the intensity of extreme events. Think of floods and droughts. This is often combined with bad governance or with inefficient water use, which means that the water resources that are actually there can't be used because they're insufficient in quantity or inadequate in quality. In addition to that, the interests of different users, this can be individual people, it can be communities, it can be sectors, it can be entire countries, often diverge, or people think they diverge. And people often feel that they compete over water resources, whether they're actually really scarce or just perceived as scarce, with their neighboring communities or their neighboring country, which leads to a competition situation between different water users, which is why the World Economic Forum has for a number of years now put water resources crisis, water crisis, high on their risk assessment, high in terms of likelihood and in terms of impact, as you can see in the graph on the right-hand side of the slide. Media has also picked up on that, of course. This is just a few headlines from the last years that depict the growing water crisis and the potential of conflict that many journalists think is indeed related to that. And you can see that the headlines cover small local places where water conflict has happened and broader geographical scopes, such as entire river basins. You see mentioning of the Nile here, but also Central Asia. In reality, however, the world looks quite different. There are water-related risks, indeed, and these risks have led to competition, instability, and conflict, And on one of the next slides, I'll be talking a bit more in detail about what we mean when we talk about conflict, instability, insecurity, and all the other terms related to the water and security nexus. But however, this is not the case in all places. There are also many places around the world where these water-related risks, drought, scarcity, floods, have actually not led to conflict, or sometimes they've even led to cooperation. Moreover, the way in which we see these water conflict nexi expressed varies a lot. If we think about water conflict, water war, the way the media portrays it, we typically think about violent clashes between different communities, between herders and fishermen, or violent clashes even between the countries. As the prominent water war thesis that was put forward in the 1990s especially has been saying, although by now we know that reality has shown us that there has never been an actual water war. And there are many more forms which the water conflict nexus can take. It can come in the form of government delegitimization and consequently destabilization. For example, if local governments or national governments cannot supply basic services, basic water supply, basic sanitation services, or cannot ensure the food security of people because there's not enough water to grow foods, this can lead to people questioning the government's legitimacy and potentially lead to social instability, always combined with a number of other factors. It can also take the form of societal frictions. It can take the form of urban-rural clashes that we see in a number of countries around the world, where the rural water supply for irrigation clashes with the interests of those inhabiting the cities needing water for their uses. Or it can take the form of diplomatic tensions. What we also note from empirical evidence is that the intensity and the severity of water-related competition or instability or conflict varies significantly around the world. There are places where we indeed see violence, violence performed with weapons, with aggression between communities, but there are also places where we see more underlying tensions that for now have not erupted into violence, but might well do so in the future, or maybe not. And also, and I think that is very important to mention here, what we also see around the world is that water can also lead to cooperation, that water can actually bring people together to cooperate and engage in joint management. So the takeaway message so far, and that's also what the training will be focusing on, is the observation that in some places and under some specific circumstances, water-related risks can lead to conflict, to competition, to instability, but it does not do so in others. So this leads us to a number of key questions which the training will be focusing on. So this first part of the Water Peace and Security Partnership training really aims at addressing the question, how are water and conflict linked? What links them? And how does it do so? And we could break that down into a number of sub-questions. Those are, for example, whether water-related risks do lead to competition and conflict at all, or maybe not. It's also the question what we mean by water-related insecurity and instability. I was highlighting a few examples earlier, but there's much more to discover there on this spectrum. It could also relate to questions of the pathways and the intervening factors that link a water-related risk with a certain insecurity or instability outcome. What are these factors that make in a certain place water resources lead to conflict, but maybe to cooperation in another place? And last but not least, how do these water risks translate themselves through, for example, food or energy security, acknowledging that one of the many causal chains that exist between water risks and security is food, not enough water being available for food production, as a consequence, food prices rising, and possibly that leading to instability and conflict. And this is exactly the questions that the Water Peace and Security Partnership focuses on in its work. The Water Peace and Security Partnership has been established in 2018. It is an initiative that is funded by the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs and also supported by GIZ, the German Development Corporation. It consists of a range of partners from think tanks, universities, international NGOs, and others. And they comprise the IHE Delft Institute for Water Education, the World Resources Institute, Deltares, Wetlands International, the Hague Center for Strategic Studies, International Alert, Klingendal, and Oregon State University. Together, these partners in the Water Peace and Security Partnership aim to address the water conflict nexus by focusing on four different pillars. Firstly, developing innovative tools and services that can help us identify water-related security risks, especially in the context of climate change, food and energy security. Secondly, raising awareness among decision makers at all governance levels, from the very local village level all the way up to the UN level, and to leverage their readiness to actually act on these risks. Thirdly, by building capacity of these decision makers, but also other actors involved in both water management and conflict management, so that they're enabled to adequately and effectively address water-related security risks. And lastly, support dialogue in conflict-affected regions that helps to ideally prevent, but possibly only mitigate or resolve water-related conflict risks. So these activities together provide the basis of the Water Peace and Security Partnership's action. Our aim is to understand water resource conflicts, to mobilize action, to help people learn about the water security nexus, and to engage in dialogue that ultimately brings them together to act urgently on the water and conflict nexus. The ultimate aim behind that is to turn vicious circle into virtuous circle. Vicious circles typically consist of a water-related challenge that is managed in an unsustainable way that leads to competition, instability, or conflict that potentially, in some places, erupts. And we want to move away from those and ensure that instead the actors using water resources contribute to virtuous cycles. Virtuous cycles are those where water-related challenges are managed effectively and in a conflict-sensitive manner so that they generate opportunities for cooperation and exchange, which ultimately contribute to stability, peace, and sustainable development. The Water Peace and Security Partnership does all this work at all governance levels and with a number of different stakeholders. I'll just introduce two here. The WPS works at the global level, where it developed a global conflict forecasting tool and publishes a quarterly conflict forecast, where it develops capacity among the global 4D community, and where it engages in awareness raising at the global and the international level and supports dialogue there. But it also works at the national and local level, currently in Mali, Niger, Chad, East Africa, Iraq, and Afghanistan, again providing analytical tools, this time at the local level, to decision makers for them to understand the current water resource situation, future resource challenges, and also potential human responses. So again, this link from a water-related risk to a certain conflict outcome. WPS at the local level also engages in capacity development for decision makers and experts at the local and national level, and again, very much in awareness raising and dialogue support. So what is this course about? This course, and especially the first lessons that you're going to follow after this introductory part, focuses on understanding this underlying water security nexus. It focuses on understanding the different linkages between water-related risks and instability, conflict and insecurity. It provides you with an overview of the current state of knowledge on the water security nexus. So what do we know about the linkages between water and security, and what do we not know yet? Where do we have to investigate further, do further research on? It introduces to you the virtues and the vicious cycles and how we can move from the vicious to the virtues. And it also introduces the role of the different intervening factors that influence these cycles. And the following two videos will zoom in more closely into these relationships at the global and at the local level. It will help you to answer these questions that I had introduced earlier. So it will help you to understand how water and security are linked with all the different sub-questions that I was discussing earlier. But it will also take things a step further and help you to respond to another set of key questions, which is how to turn the vicious into the virtuous cycle. So you'll get to know the current state of research and developments that have been done in the past year with regards to which role hydrological and natural factors play in deciding whether water-related risks lead to security challenges or rather to cooperation, and which role man-made factors play there. Governance, for example. It will help you to understand the role of institutions, the role they can play in preventing water-related conflicts, or at least mitigating them. It will introduce you to the concept of conflict-sensitive water management, and it will introduce you to the different factors that determine the link between water and security, and help you to understand which of those are maybe more prone to governance interventions and to moving from the vicious to the virtuous cycle. It will also provide you, as I was saying, with a comprehensive state of knowledge of the water and security nexus. I do not want to go into detail here. I would just like to mention a few things that we do know already and that you will know at the end of this module. You'll understand the risks and the instability and conflict factors that are linked to water-related risks. You will also have understood that water is hardly the only and sole cause of instability and conflict, but rather often acts as a threat multiplying factor, along with many others. You'll also understand what these other factors are and how the different ones, such as food and energy security, economic development, population growth, and governance, not only influence the nexus, but can maybe also be used to turn things to the positive side. So what you'll learn in this course, I've summarized here in the learning objectives for you. And it would be good if you always go back when you stop the course for a moment, when you take a pause, to go back to those and check in whether you've learned these things and whether you still have questions. So the idea is that you'll be able to explain and identify the interlinkages between water, peace and security, including key concepts, that you'll be able to discuss and reflect on the complex relationships between water and insecurity, that you'll know the definitions of the different dimensions of conflict and cooperation, and also that you'll understand the WPS approach. I know that e-learning can be very challenging. You might be sitting at home, or you might be sitting in your office. You have a busy life, but still you decided to take this WPS course, which we from the Water, Peace and Security Partnership are very happy about. And we can only encourage you to follow through the course, and we really hope that it will help you to make your contribution to making the world a more cooperative, more sustainable, and more peaceful water world.